I'm sure he might have,
might even have his newest one out there, right? So on your way out, pick that up. Of course, now, once again, we'd like to welcome you to the premier event of the 2022 Jazz in June, Tennessee Valley Jazz Society. And of course, tonight, we are honored to have with us the Golden Striker Trio, right? And then we're going to introduce them on piano, Mr. Donald Baker. In fact, I was talking with Donald backstage and found out that we're homeboys. He lived, you know, lived in LA for a long time, so yeah, all right, dude. Also joining us this evening on guitar, great guitarist, Mr. Russell Malone. To Russell that I did an interview with him on the show back in 2015. Of course, he did not remember that, but it was a great interview. Anyway, also then we'd like to, of course, introduce our special guest, the great bassist, Mr. Ron Carter.
Thank you. first song was written for a movie I did, a soundtrack called Eddie's Theme. Those of you who know my small history know that I played with a guitar player named Jim Hall. A lovely man, fantastic guitar player, and a dear friend whom I miss to this day. This next piece is one of Jim's favorite that I have in the pen. Here's both the view of Cedar Tree, of Candlelight. Jim Hall, also alone. Thank you. Let's go to Paul. he's sitting there. Russell Mulder plays good. He writes really nice songs. His next song is written by Russell, dedicated to our mutual friend, the late, great Cedar Walton. We had a great time together, and again, we miss him terribly. Anyway, this is Russell's view of Cedar Walton's humor. This is called Cedar Tree. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Cedar Tree. About 30 years ago, a guy came to New York named Antonio Carlos Jobim. And with that name came this music called Boston Over. We called the Boston Outward Over. And I had the chance to play with him on many records, and this is a song that's dedicated to our memory of him. Antonio Carlos Jobim, here is Opus 5. Thank you. a nice song.
Thank you.
piece is dedicated to the ballad that one of my favorite band leaders liked to play every night for 5.5 years. I finally learned it last week. And we really love you. finish off our program by playing a song by Fitch Henderson called Soft Winds. I finally learned this, but couldn't bring it out in order to play it, so here it is. Thank you.
welcome you tonight to the premier event for the 2022 Jazz in June, sponsored by the Tennessee Valley Jazz Society. I'll take my mask off. And of course, I'm Douglas Turner, host of Return to the Source on WJAB 90.9 FM. I'd like to welcome all of you here this evening, and of course, I'm here. And I'm being joined tonight by, of course, one of the greatest bassists in music, period. Of course, especially in jazz, Mr. Ron Carter. How about a round of applause? Mr. Carter, so for those of you who don't know much about him, of course, according to the Guinness Book of World Records, he's the most recorded bassist in music, not just in jazz, but in music. Of course, he's appeared on more than 2,000 recordings, and over his long career, he's performed and recorded with many of the greats in jazz, including people like Miles Davis, Eric Dolphy, Chico Hamilton, Tommy Flanagan, Gil Evans, Bill Evans, Dexter Gordon, Wes Montgomery, just to name a few. I mean, you know, probably be easier to say who he hasn't played with than who he has played with. But of course, also, he has also had a long and active career as an educator. He's been a distinguished professor of music emeritus at the City College of New York. He's a multiple Grammy Award winning artist. In fact, he just won a Grammy this year for Best Jazz Album. Is called Skyline, and it features Ron Carter with Gonzalo Rubalcaba and Jack DeJohnette. Of course, he's also scored and arranged music for films, and he's written several books on playing the bass, including Building a Jazz Bassline. He's the recipient of several honorary doctorate degrees. He was named an American Jazz Master by the National Endowment for the Arts in 1998. And I was mentioning to him backstage that I was there that night in New York at the International Association of Jazz Educators Conference the night he received his award. So, of course, also, let me mention, too, this is the first time that you've been in Alabama, right? Is that right, Ron?
Yes.
How did that happen? how is this the first time you've been in
Alabama? Alex kept nagging me to get down here, so here I am.
All right. Now, you know, I want to talk to you about we don't have a lot of time, so I want to talk to you about sort of your beginning, and I want to go back to Detroit. A lot of great jazz musicians have come from Detroit. Tommy Flanagan, Kenny Burrell, Barry Harris, Donald Byrd, yourself, and, you know, the Elton Jones brothers. You know, just we could go on. What was it about Detroit, and particularly Cass Tech, because I know you went to Cass Tech High School. What was it about Detroit at that time that produced so many great musicians?
Well, at that time in Detroit, I was not a jazz player. I was a classical cellist. And I was thought of as being one of the very talented young colored kids from Ferndale, Michigan, which was a block from Detroit. I didn't start to play jazz until I graduated from Cass Tech and moved to Rochester, New York, where I got a scholarship to the Eastman School of Music, a very famous music conservatory. And the scholarship I got was not enough to really help me stay in school. And fortunately, my neighbor in Detroit was a jazz saxophonist and said that he had some work for the summer playing for the fraternities and sororities at Detroit festivals. And could I help him out? I said, well, I don't know the music, but if I can read it, I can figure it out. So my first gigs were in Detroit as a jazz player, but I was not a jazz player in Detroit. I went to school at Eastman, got a degree in bass. Guy said, well, look, you know, you play pretty good. If you come to New York, you'll find work because New York wants good bass players. Yeah.
Well, you know, and I know you
here I am. Here I am.
And I know you initially wanted to be a classical, you wanted to be in the symphony orchestra,
yes.
But at that time there were not the opportunities for African-American musicians. Has that changed much?
I keep saying no, but no one has the audacity to challenge that no. I think if they look at pictures from the 50s, 60s, and 70s, and see if the ratio of minorities and people of color has increased with the proportion of people of color in those schools that are turning out these players, you'll find that the proportion has not measurably changed.
Now, I know your good friend, Richard Davis.
Yes.
You know, had a program for young bassists, and I know you were involved in that. Has that been successful, and is that a way to increase at least the number of, you know, bassists of color? Not, and I guess it wasn't just to produce jazz bassists, but just give kids an opportunity to play the bass, right?
Well, it keeps them off the street and not having anything better to do. I've known Richard and loved him for a very, very long time. He's a dear friend of mine, a fabulous player, and a great conceptionist as to how to teach the instrument. And when he began this program up in Madison, Wisconsin, I encouraged him because I thought it was a great idea, not just to keep the kids busy, but to help propagate some of the people of color bass players' concept of how the bass can also be played. And until his latest illness, he was managing the program very well, a very successful program that's still going. And I hope that he's planted enough seeds that those young people will be able to carry the flag and do what he would no longer be able to do.
Okay. Now, and let me ask you, you know, as I mentioned, you know, it would be easier to mention the people you haven't played with. But one of the people I'd like you to talk about, and one that you did some of your very first recordings with, and people don't really talk about him a lot, and that's Eric Dolphy. Tell me a little bit about your recollections of Eric Dolphy.
Well, there aren't very many. You know, most of those records I made back then were all done in the studio. I made not one concert with Eric Dolphy's band. I worked with him with Chico Hamilton when I joined the band in August of 1959. And the band stayed together until January of 1960, where I re-enrolled in Manhattan for a master's. Eric and Chico moved to New York, and Eric joined Charlie Mingus's band as a band member and continued to make music under his own name, which I was a part of those projects. I can best tell you that Eric was a fervent believer in practicing. He practiced everything all the time. He didn't know how to cook, so my wife showed him how to make some basic food so he could kind of make a menu to get along and eat some meal. He really played ahead of his time, and it's unfortunate that his passing was under such uncomfortable circumstances. But we all knew and loved him, and we miss him as we speak.
Okay. Also, I'd like you to comment on a couple of recordings that were not jazz related, and they were recordings that I always liked because you were on them and where you played on them. One of them was Roberta Flack's recording. The first time ever I saw your bass, and especially Trying Times. How did you come up with that bass line? I can think of the bass line right now.
Okay, well, Roberta was working in Washington, D.C., and she was kind of discovered by Les McCann. And Les McCann had called her to producer in New York, Atlantic, to record this great piano player singer in Washington. So he invited Roberta down to New York for his session. And it seems after 2 days they didn't get much done. I think one of the things that young players don't understand, that making a gig is one thing. Making a record, that's another degree. And evidently they were so frustrated with no progress. The producer, who was a friend of mine, called me and said, I got this singer from Washington who's got a great little arrangements and trios, and I'm trying to make a record with her, but the band doesn't know how to make a record. Can you come to the studio and make it? Say, okay. The record is called First Take. And from that record were three or four tracks that made her name really, really, really big. She's a wonderful pianist, a great singer. And she became one of my dear friends because she trusted my comment to her. And she trusted my choice of notes would make her eye into something else. Well, I'm still looking for those notes, so today I'll find some more.
Because I can still remember that baby.
I'll say that for you.
another artist I would like you to talk about, of course, a non-jazz artist, and you appeared on his recording. Was Gil Scott here? How did that happen?
It was the same thing, it was kind of an accident. Someone recommended Gil to the producer, and the band was a kind of a jam band. They just got together and played. And unless without any discipline and understanding of how to play in a studio. The records weren't getting anywhere because they were kind of inexperienced. Wonderful players. Nice guy.
Were you surprised by his musicianship? I mean, he was a great musician.
And I trusted that he was a guy because he was in charge. And he asked me to help him make this record. I said, well, you know, I've played with singers before, so the idea is not new, but what are you singing? So I said, he gave me some words of Revolution Will Not Be Televised. I said, go ahead, yeah. Sign me up.
Yeah. And I especially like the work you did on the tune Pieces of a Man.
But, yes.
But anyway, another musician, of course, that we want to talk about, of course, you spent a lot of time with Miles. We don't want to spend a lot of time talking about Miles.
Good.
What would you say is sort of a highlight of the time you spent with Miles?
I've never answered those kind of questions.
Yeah.
Because it means that all the other times were not valuable.
Yeah.
And they were all of excellent opportunity to watch a masterwork every night for 5.5 years. Knowing that he thought I was his equal.
Well,
that's
you know,
great.
When you're talking about going in the studio, in the early 70s, of course, you did a lot of work for CTI Records. And they were a studio, you know, I mean, that's what
studio
they did.
Man.
Yeah, that's what they did, right? So Don Sobieski, you worked with him a lot. What are some of your impressions about Don Sobieski?
A great writer, very, very efficient. He trusted my judgment to make his bass part sound like he wrote it, and he played very well.
Because I remember the first time I saw you was you were on a tour with the CTI All-Stars,
yeah.
And I saw you in Los Angeles.
Yeah.
But, of course, you've been at this for over 6 decades. Do you still enjoy going on the road? I know you still enjoy playing, but do you enjoy it? And the audience won't be mad if you say, no, I don't enjoy it. But do you enjoy going on the road still, Ron?
No. it's just more difficult. Now. The situation is completely different.
Yeah.
I used to be able to take my bass inside the plane or walk to the tarmac and load it. Those days are just a memory. And just because there are times, the more you people travel, not just going to the airport, but going to the store, you run the errands, the whole vibe is not conducive to having a good time getting there to do it.
Well, you know, I remember, and it's interesting you said, because I remember it was sometime in the 70s when the time I was on a plane coming from New York to LA, and John Hurd was sitting across the aisle, and he had his bass, you know, in a seat next to him. And so I guess they don't allow that anymore.
Not a chance.
Do you travel with your own bass, or do you just get a bass wherever you go?
Well, right now it's kind of bass du jour, which is the bass of the day. But that's another challenge. Can I make this bass sound like it belongs to me? So if you guys hang around, we'll see how I do.
All right. Now, as I mentioned, of course, you won a Grammy this year for your album, Skyline. Does winning a Grammy, I don't want to ask, does it mean anything to you? Because I know it means something to you. But do you attach the significance to a Grammy that, say, the casual person would? What does a Grammy mean to you? Because it's not the first time you won a Grammy, but what does a Grammy mean to you?
It means that enough people who hear a pretty broad selection of record types and styles and their listening experience and their age groups have decided that of all the records they heard in this category, this record is the best they've heard for this year.
Do you have to do campaigning, or do you have to have a record label behind you? Because, you know, there are a lot of great records that get released every year. A lot of them don't get heard by these people who make these decisions. So is it better to have a record label behind you? Is that one way that a record label would help?
All I can do is play the music. Everything else is kind of out of my grasp. I appreciate those who make those choices, because they are not easy choices. You're correct. Having said that, I like that record.
Yeah. Now, of course, once again, is there anybody in the audience that maybe had a question? And we're not going to, you know, belabor this, but maybe one person. You're the first person to raise your hand. Come on. stand up and ask a question.
I'm not sure what you mean, doesn't have a scene.
What
does that mean, doesn't have a scene?
No jazz scene in that area.
In New York, guys make a scene. People go by the local pizza shop, the local small restaurant, and talk to one into having a duo play for lunch, or a duo play for the afternoon Sunday night, Sunday gospel brunch in New York, for example. They make a place to play, and if they really mean it, and then there's more than one of those guys. I'll make it a musically very eventful situation. I've done that years ago with Duke Pearson, my piano player. I did with Bobby Timlin. We started the duo scene in New York on that level because we wanted to play. And those places where we played, there were nice bars, you know, Italian, Irish bars. They had nice jukebox with no live music. And Bobby or Timlin or Duke were conversant enough and determined to have music that when they want to play, to talk these places into having a duo for two nights a week. As it turned out, it spawned a whole New York duo piano and bass scene. And it became legendary in the 60s and 70s. So it's possible.
Just one final question, Ron. I'm going to let you go ahead and get started. In terms of, you know, the quartet that you had, where you were primarily playing cello or piccolo bass, tell me a little bit about the concept behind that group.
Well, like every musician, they want to be the band leader. They've had enough of taking comments, taking advice, being asked to some place long if they don't want to play, getting less pay, and smaller name on the marquee. At some point, all those people, male and female, they want to be a guy or gal in charge of that. For me to make that work, I wanted an instrument that would make people walk in the door and say, that's the band leader. So to make that happen, I had a guy who doesn't make me a small bass called piccolo bass that literally puts me in the center of the band. So when you walk in, you see a small bass, a very tall guy. You see a big bass and a very small guy. Great Kenny Barron on piano and Ben Riley on drums for 5 years. We had a great, great time. And because we were so curious about this two bass quartet, people began to hear and say, man, these got some nice arrangements. They look great, they're wearing matching ties and stuff, like this band will tonight, you know. They allowed us to work with this bass duo quartet for 4 or 5 years before Charlie Rouse formed them and they had other things to do and I got busy with CTI. But I thought that it was a chance for me to do the things I had learned from all those band leaders. And then there were 20 and 30, a lot of them. They all had their way of programming the music. They had their own way of how fast a song was going to play. They determined how long the solos were going to play. They understood that maybe this night there'd be no drum solos, and if the guy didn't like it, see you later. You know, they decided when the band would work, how often they could work. They decided on the band payroll, band hotel, the band travel. I liked all of that. I haven't done that in almost 3 years now with this long intermission we're on. That was the first thing I missed, not being responsible for that. And the second thing I missed most of all, or appreciated most of all, was that knowing that every night for the next 2.5 years, I knew where the peanut butter was in my house and the bathroom light switch.
Yeah, all right, and thank you. Once again, how about a round of applause?